I've been the sexton of St. Mark's Cemetery for nearly 20 years, and over those 20 years, a great deal of knowledge of the cemetery rests in my head. And it's time that some of this information is shared for the wider public. I'm here in the cemetery at St. Mark's with my good friend Fred Havermill. Fred and I both were teachers at Niagara College and both retired in 1990. We took up an interest in genealogy at that point and began by transcribing stones in several cemeteries. As a result of that, together we wrote Stones, Saints, and Sinners, a book published by the Niagara Historical Museum. We have worked on other books during this period of our retirement, and I think we're now at number 18. I'd like you to meet Fred.
Thank you. Dorothy Carnathan Bauer was a local member of the parish. Her father owned a hotel up on Queen Street. After he died, he was buried at the site, and this is the story of a recycled grave site. The family then moved down to the United States, and somehow Dorothy became extremely wealthy. She built a mausoleum in order to have her father and mother bodies transferred to the mausoleum, and she and her husband were buried there as well. However, there was the little question of what to do with the grave, so she wrote a letter to the rector and said that her cousins, the Taylors, could be given the grave as long as they would remove their names of her parents from the tombstone. And so you see they've done that, and this is all cleared, and the Taylors were two brothers. If you look at the base, however, you'll notice that here it says father, and on the other side, mother. Neither of them was mother. Obviously, they didn't quite do their job thoroughly.
This is the final resting place of Dorothy Carnathan and her husband and her mother and her father, and was supposed to have been the final resting place of her brother and his wife, but they unfortunately didn't make it here. When we began the study of Dorothy Carnathan, we knew absolutely nothing. No date, no place, nothing. After several years of research, we found out quite a bit. She was one interesting lady. I'm going to leave you with Fred to fill that in.
She gave money for two windows in the church, and that's what really originally interested us to try to discover who she was. When we put a note in the bulletin, we did find out somebody had a picture of this lady who used to come every year. In fact, she came every year to St. Mark's. She kept up her pew rent, which meant she had a place in the congregation itself. And then, in correspondence with the minister, she had this magnificent mausoleum built for her and her husband and her parents, as Donald has said, complete with this huge urn in front of it. It must have cost her a few dollars because there are even stained glass windows in the side of the mausoleum. This is one of the many stories of slavery represented in this cemetery, but this is slavery of quite a different kind. This is a monument to Katharina Hayden. Now, Katharina, in fact, was born Greek, but when she was very small, she was captured by the Turks and carried off, and eventually ended up as a slave in Egypt. When the British ambassador discovered her, she was already speaking her third language. But she did remember a little bit of Greek, so he could determine that her name was in fact Catherine or Katharina. It was a bit of difficulty finding out what her surname was. Eventually she was left with the surname Hayden, and it's suspected that that was the name she was given. Probably just means slave, but it was the name she was called by and it was the name she remembered. The ambassador took her back to Britain. She was raised there as his daughter, eventually married a man named Pafford. Two brothers were named Pafford, both came to Canada, the third remained in Britain. The one became mayor of the town. In fact, all those pictures of maple trees along Queen Street were the result of his work, and the park across the road was really the result of his decision as mayor of town. The other brother was a chemist, and in both St. Catharines and here at various times, she was the wife of the chemist. The chemist was her husband. So that's the story of Katharina Hayden, a little Greek slave who was an early resident of Niagara-on-the-Lake.